For all those who appreciate the work that we're doing here on Standing for Truth, please hit that subscribe button because we are just getting started.
I want to introduce our second speaker today, Stef Hierema. He's a Dutchman. He holds a BSc in aircraft engineering. He's on the board of two Dutch apologetics organizations, Logos Institute and Forum C. He has experience in heat treatment processes in molten salt, commercial steam installations, and the engineering of uranium enrichment in the UK. He's done work with Urenco. And he gives lectures on salt formations and flood geology. This one might stretch you a little bit, but Stef is going to do his best to make it accessible for us all. So without more ado, welcome Stef Hierema.
Thank you very much, Philip. It's very kind of you for inviting me here. I'm indeed a board member of Logos Institute, and that's quite a look-alike as CMI. So I'm a young Earth creationist, but I'm also in the board of Forum C, and that's not quite a young Earth creationist organization. Apart from this, I'm a member of some geologic societies in the Netherlands. There are two Dutch societies, and I'm a member of both of them. And just last week, there was a board member, coming to my house to tell me that, because I had done a request to the board to open a meeting for me to give me the ability to give my thoughts on salt formations. That's a geologic fact. So I would share my thoughts in a meeting with the society, and a board member came to my house to tell me that I was not allowed to share my creationist views in their meetings. So, well, that's where I'm in, and I will tell you a lot more about this kind of things. Before I start with all that, I think it's a good thing what Philip did with these 2 days, to start with the Bible. I will copy that in my presentation. And that's about salt. When the church loses its saltiness, then how can it be made salty again? We have Catholic churches in the Netherlands, and also just last week, the Archbishop of the Catholic churches in the Netherlands announced we have 280 churches now, and within 10 years we will close them all down but 15. So in 10 years' time we will go down from 280 to 15. And they are trendsetting. I'm very sure that they are trendsetting. Within a couple of years we will hear the same from our Protestant churches in the Netherlands. And within another decennium or some decennia, all Pentecostal, Baptist, Evangelist churches will follow this trend, I'm sure. And that is all to do with churches that are not fighting against evolution theory, because they are without solid rock under their feet. Has been said before. So if the church is being silenced in this discussion, the church is silenced on evolution. They don't fight against evolution. If the church is silenced, then Jesus said, then Well, I tell you, if they keep quiet, the stones will cry out. And that's what my talk's about. The salt of the earth. And it will speak open and friendly and well, boldly, I think so, about some things. I don't know how well you are informed about the salt formations of the earth. So how are there some people here that know about these salt formations in the solid rock hidden in the subsurface? There are only a few, and some of them are known already, so that means that most of you don't know what I'm talking about. Well, that's very good then. I think that's quite right the time to open this up for you. As the Salt Association here in the UK announces on their website, the rock salt deposits in the UK are found at Cleveland, County Antrim, and below the Cheshire town of Winsford. They were formed some 220 million years ago during the Triassic geological period. At this time, central England consisted of a series of inland seas that were regularly replenished by the surrounding oceans, and the combination of the inland seas and the desert environment led to slow evaporation. Whoa, is the present the key to the past? No, it's quite not. And our Bible tells us that the past is the key to the present and the past is the key to the future. But theologists and evolutionists, they say the present is the key to the past, and anyone can look out the window and see, well, it's not true what they say. So this is just storytelling. It's a story, and do you want to believe it or not? Well, the fact, I'm quite driven by observations. I really like experimental observations. And well, now in Winsford, you can come down, you can go down there, and there is a deep underground storage. And if you have a high valuable archive that you want to store in a safe place, a safe and a dry place, then you can go to Winsford and bring it there, and they will store it for you in the safest place, in the driest rock of the earth. So how likely is it that this rock indeed was caused by evaporation of water, because now it's the driest rock on earth? That's an experimental observation. I just say, well, that's opposite to its origin. And there are other big formations of salt. This is the salt formation, the Permian Sechstein. And you see how it's been stretched out from the coastline of the UK. A huge formation underneath the North Sea, underneath the north of the Netherlands, where I live. Germany, Denmark, Poland. It's a huge formation, 500,000 square kilometers. And it goes on farther north. 500,000 square kilometers. And the thickness of this salt in average is about, well, at least a half a kilometer thick, and maybe 1 kilometer thick. That means that we are talking about 250,000 cubic kilometers of salt, up to 500,000 cubic kilometers of salt. So now you know a lot more about salt in the UK. We bought some, I think this is out of the Himalaya, we bought some of this salt, and normally I bring my own salt to conferences, but to bring this in an airplane and to explain it to officials. So Philip was so kind to buy some salt off the internet, and this has been electrical wired because they can a lamp be fitted in, and this is Himalayan salt, and I don't know exactly where it came from. It's not exactly as clean as I would have thought it should have been. I see some, well, whatever, this is some examples. So I will pass it through, and you can, well, check about the crystals, check about the hardness, well, have an impression of salt. Well, anyone must make sure that he is able to touch this. The colors are a bit different, but the funny thing with these crystals is you've only used a very little bit of iron or a little bit of some whatever, and the color of these crystals will change radically. So, okay, that's to give you an impression about salt. Now you know a lot more about salt in your country. There's also here in this area, underneath this salt, you find the gas fields, the Trent and the Bolton gas fields. Maybe you know about that, I don't know. Farther north, it's not on the screen, by the Shetland Isles, there you have the Brent oil. The Brent oil is, oil fields on top of salt layers. It's above salt layers where these gas fields are subsalt. So, this association with oil and gas is worldwide. We find these salt layers worldwide, you know, every continent we find them, and we see this strong association with oil and gas. You see all these formations worldwide, and then here there is this big Great Rift, the Great Rift through Africa. It starts in Syria, runs through the Jordan Valley, through the Dead Sea, and behold, underneath the Dead Sea, there is a 10-kilometer thick salt formation sitting in this big fault zone in the earth, in the crust. Then farther south, we find the Red Sea formation, a huge salt formation sitting in this fault zone in the crust. Then farther south, we found the Dinakil Desert. The Dinakil Desert underneath there is a 5-kilometer thick salt formation sitting in this fault zone. Then farther south, there we find a volcano, the Old Doño Lenghe, which is a mountain, a volcano that delivers every day. Also today, I expect there shall be delivered as well, because it's continuously flowing. It's a salt volcano. It's a salt volcano. It's the only one on Earth that's active. And it's not only delivering salt, it's also delivering other materials, other chemicals. So it's a mixture of everything. But there is quite a lot of salt in this magma as well. So I come to the conclusion, and I'm not the only one who came to that conclusion. James Hutton is with me on this, and this is the first and only time I agree with James Hutton. Yes, indeed, this salt must have had an origin in a volcano. It's just magma. So that brings me to conclusion number one, and there will follow some more during this presentation, because else I was done already. rock salt is much more likely of volcanic origin because its volume, its dryness, there are no shells inside this salt, there's nothing in this salt really that says, well, I'm from the sea. We see this fossil fuel sub and top salt, and that's a funny one. When you consider a flood, a worldwide flood, that's delivering a lot of water, this water delivers a lot of sediments. And these sediments become in the sedimentation process, and it is causing a lot of mud, kilometers thick layers of mud, and then suddenly it's being injected from underneath with a magma, a salt magma. And a salt magma is thin like water. It's not very slow. No, it runs like water. I've melted myself. It's very, very thin. And then it will run into this mud, and the heat of the magma will transfer any organics what has been buried in the mud of the flood. It will transfer this organic material into oil and gas, into fossil fuels. And that's exactly what we see. We see the gas fields underneath the salt. We see also oil underneath the salt. We see oil on top of salt formation, because it was being sedimented, that that huge catastrophe, watery catastrophe, continued to bury all this salt underneath new sediments, and all these sediments contained organics, and also these organics were transferred into gas and oil. Oh, by the way, I've done some publications about it in the Journal of Creation in 2009. For the Germans, for the German language, I've also presented it in 2010 in German in Factum. And as I'm an engineer, I went to companies, mining companies, and I told them, I can help you to find your specific salt you are looking for, like Netmag. Netmag is a Netherlands company. They are searching for magnesium chloride, especially magnesium chloride. And most of these salt formations are sodium chloride, but what's now passing through the rows, those are sodium chloride, mainly pure sodium chloride. But there are also layers of quite pure magnesium chloride inside this salt formation. And this company is just looking for those. So I went to with my talk, and they said, well, you have to listen to my talk because I have a better view on its origin, and I can help you. Because magnesium chloride is very hydrophilic. It's, when it smells water, it will absorb it. That water out of the air will be absorbed in magnesium chloride. It's highly, highly unlikely to get that by an evaporation process. Because you have to evaporate all the water, and then the magnesium chloride will rest in your basin, and then in this view of geologists, they have to replenish this basin again to bring in new salt, to bury the magnesium chloride underneath new salt. But by replenishing the basin, the magnesium chloride will be in solution again. Do you copy that? So you will never end up with magnesium chloride in a salt formation, not in their way. It's only possible if it was from a volcanic origin, then it can be done. So this organization was, this company was quite happy with my view, and they say, well, you know what, we will introduce you in a meeting with all Dutch mining companies that are in salt, and you can speak there and bring your message there. So I was in the boardroom of Frisia, and in front of the directors of Netmag, Frisia, Axo, I presented my view. Salt. And the director of Frisia, one of the directors of Frisia, said, well, that explains to me why I never see a shell in this salt. Because they had this, they drill in this salt, they take out from kilometers deep, they take out cores, very expensive, but they take out cores and for their investigation. And so it was on the table there in this director room. And there are no shells in there. There's nothing. Well, anyway. We'll go on an intermezzo about oil and gas, just to give you some more impression about what's going on in the Earth. Forget about the pillars, I will come on that in a minute. I will come on these pillars in a minute. But this is such a salt layer has been buried underneath sand, clay and chalk. Sand, clay and chalk has been delivered by a watery flood. And in this sand, clay and chalk layers, there is a high porosity. There is a lot of water in all these pores. And these pores are connected by which the hydraulic water pressure is available in the pores. So the deeper you go, the higher the pressure of the water works in these pores. And when you go underwater 10 meters, you face one bar. 20 meters, two bars, 1 kilometer, 100 bar, 4 kilometer, 400 bar. And the gas that has been formed in all these pores, that's lighter than water, that's less dense than the water, and will float upon the water. And oil will do the same, it will float upon the water. So it will be brought up until it meets a ceiling of salt. Because salt, as you will see, and if you have it in your hand, there is no porosity. The salt is solid. So this gas will sitting there, it will be pressed to the pressure of water. The hydraulic water pressure will work in this gas. That means that if you drill towards this gas field, and you start drilling, and you go through the salt, and boom, 400 bars to your equipment, yes? And what we now face in the Netherlands is, that's in the area where I live, this gas is taken out very fast during several decennia, and now this water should flow into this area to get it pressurized again. However, the distance is several hundreds of kilometers. From the south edge of this Sechstein formation, it has to flow underneath the salt over at least 100 kilometers northwards to this place. And so the pressure is decreasing here. And by that, the overburden, the weight of the overburden is pushing its way down, and we have earthquakes in our area. So never trust a geologist. Never trust him. When they say we can safely drill underneath your house and we can safely take something out, don't trust them. And if they say evolution is true, don't trust them either. Yeah. Okay. I think that's about... And I see the lithostatic pressure. Lithostatic pressure, that's the pressure of all the rocks on top of it. So the overburden, that's the lithostatic. That the rocks is much more dense than the water. So you've got two pressures inside. You have the lithostatic, the weight of all the rocks, and you have the hydrostatic pressure. Okay. Conclusion two, and that's quite a change now of the subject, but I can, from this experimental observation, we can conclude there is enough water in the earth. Because everywhere where we drill, there's always water. There are no dry drillings. And the deepest drilling is 13 kilometers deep, and our earth is nearly 13,000 kilometers in diameter, so we know everything about our earth. Or not. But there is enough water in the earth. These pores are filled up with water. Rock crystals contain water. Any volcanic eruption delivers a lot of water. So now, only our experiments show us there is enough water for the flood. It requires just a very strong hand to squeeze the water out of the earth. I can imagine that. Yeah. Okay. This is where I live. The subsurface of the north of the Netherlands. I live about here in this area, and you can believe it or not, but I live in a mountainous area. Mountains up to 3 kilometers high. Are you still with me? You don't believe me, do you? But it is. All these salt pillars are hidden in the subsurface. They are covered with sand clay and chalk layers delivered by the flood, and it all works flat. But this is where I live, in a mountainous area. And I'm not the only one. There are multiple mountain ridges buried underneath the subsurface. These mountains are up to 6 kilometers high. And here in the UK, part of the UK, I don't know how deep they are, how high they are. I'm not informed about these. If all these mountains, now we will deal with these pillars. The origin of these pillars is fascinating. If these pillars were formed by plate tectonics, then you would have end up probably with something like this. Because you move two continents and everything in between will rise sky high. However, that's not the case. In the Netherlands and everywhere on Earth, we find these pillars everywhere on Earth. We see that these pillars are buried underneath mud layers and they are smeared out. And this here, this is 200 meters, by the way. You think they are touching the surface, and they do indeed, however, it's still 200 meters. So but you see how these salt pillars have been. Yeah, they have been piercing through some mud, and the mud just gave way, and it's the mud has been pierced out, and by mass wasting, it just flew everywhere. But it didn't form a high mountain on top of it. These are kinds of pillars from everywhere on the earth. You find these kind of things. And again, you can't imagine this being formed by plate tectonics. And by the way, these pillars, they can reach up 10 kilometers high and all be buried underneath Champlain and chalk layers. So if plate tectonics were active to create these pillars of salt, it doesn't fit because there is a unidirectional flow towards the center in which the pillar rises up. So what has really happened here? Well, I always go to geologists for their opinion to start with. Not to believe them, but to start with, to give an impression, to get an impression. And this is a huge atlas, this picture. I bought this atlas. It has been written by an editorial team with Doornenbal, Mr. Doornenbal, that was the head of it. I've met this man. I come later. I will come back on that later. This is a huge atlas. It's an atlas. It requires 2 chairs in my office to open it wide. And they say the density of most rock salts increases with depth. The density of most rocks increases with depth. That's this sedimentary rock. What are all these sediments? But salt does not increase. The density of salt does not increase. At depth, therefore, salt is relatively less dense and more buoyant than its cover, leading to instability. And salt can also flow. So in unstable conditions, a bed of salt may move sideways. And sideways means 25 kilometers in Annapolis. It's amazing. It moves underneath an overburden, 25 kilometers. That's an experimental observation I agree with. I really believe that salt was that movable. Cylindrical salt domes and linear salt walls are created if the rising salt pierces the overlying strata. Well, I don't buy this all, but this is what they say. And the fact is, they are now giving something that you can measure. They talk about density, and density that has been measured. Well, let's check. What do these geologists do with these densities? And then you see, well, they are quite agreeing about the density of these rock salts, 2,200 kilograms per cubic meter. But the overburden, they have all kinds of ideas, wild ideas about the density of the overburden. And they need a very dense overburden to push this salt up. So they go everywhere with this density. So, but what density is correct? Well, let's start with the salt ones. The salt does not have any porosity. And salt is thus the salts we find in this salt formation are sodium chloride, calcium sulfate, calcium carbonate, potassium chloride, magnesium chloride, that kind of salts. And if you then look into the density, you come up with an average weighted density of 2,350 kilograms per cubic meter for the salt layers. However, if that's a magma, if it wasn't, because now salt is an ionic solid, it's ions, cations, anions, and it's an ionic solid. If you melt them, it becomes an ionic liquid. And an ionic liquid at these temperatures then has a density of only 1,800 kilograms per cubic meter. So that's interesting. And now I'm the first engineer on Earth, I'm the first researcher on Earth that's actually checked densities for these models. Yeah, really? Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. I couldn't find anything in literature. They've written about salt. You can fill this building with what has been written on salt, but nowhere in it you will find an actually check on observations. Please give me the experimental observations. So what I did, I went to TNO. TNO is an organization in the Netherlands that has been assigned by the Dutch law, the Dutch mining law, to receive all information that's been available by mining companies. So a mining company can do a drilling and they can investigate whatever they want, but after 5 years, the mining law demands you got to bring this to TNO, and TNO will open it wide for anyone, any researcher. This is me. So I went to that, and I could check their densities, because they had checked the densities and they had all stored it on the internet. I can easily come to that by internet. And I found over 2,000 actual densities, and I found out that, at the surface, the density of rock, sedimentary rock, is very low, but it increases very fast. And then at a level of 500 meters deep, it will slowly rise, increase. But what you see in here is that solid rock salt is more dense in average than this overburden. So it will not work. The density of rock salt, the density will never come up in such an overburden. However, if it was a magma, yes, then it has a buoyancy, and then it can rise up. So, conclusion number three, density contrast support a magmatic origin. And geologists develop models based upon incorrect data, which is frustrating to see in science. I did publish that. I did two presentations at TNO, and my first, I had a meeting with three geologists at TNO. This Mr. Doornbal, the man who wrote this big atlas, attended the meeting as well. And they said, well, this is interesting. You have to come back for all our geologists. So I came back made this available for all their geologists. And by that time, I had written a paper and sent it to a secular journal, because I'm a member of one of these Dutch societies, the geological societies, and I presented my work in the society, and the work is the normal way is to present it in a journal. So I presented it, and this editorial team had already emailed me, we will certainly accept this paper. And at TNO, I met one of the editorial teams, one of the editors, and he again agreed, yes, we will certainly publish your new insights in salt formations. And which they did, indeed. By the end of 2015, this journal published my views. And then something very strange happened. The board of the Dutch Geologic Society became mad. This was not allowed. A young earth creationist to present their view in their journal. So they published on their website, this is totally wrong, it shouldn't have been published. Without any evidence, any discussion, none. Just a dot. This should never have been published. Okay. So that's science. That's how science works. It has also been published on a congress in America in 2015. So, and now we come to the core of this presentation. So hold on tight. Now you're going deep. Well, whatever. We will come back to it for the lay persons in just a couple of minutes. But because what I want to show you are geologists without any experimental observations? No, they are not. They have done their homework. But you have to go into it to understand what's the flaw in it. So they did quite a lot of experimental work. What they did is just take some of the salt and just a piece of salt of 300 millimeter high, diameter 150 millimeter, and then you put a pressure on it, 10 megapascal, 100 bar, which means about 500 meters of rock. And you put it on the, under this pressure during months, and very slowly, the diameter will increase, and there you see the flow of rock salt underneath the pressure. But there are many problems with their experiments. The first one, they did it in the wrong order, the wrong way. What we have seen, we have a unidirectional flow towards the center and going up. What they test is easier to push back a pillar into its basic layer. And the other way around is much more difficult. So this one, the observation number one. Observation number two. They gave a pressure of about 500 meter of rock, and it expanded over a distance of 75 millimeter to zero. So you have a huge pressure, and 75 millimeter away, there is the pressure zero. Whereas in their model, you've got here salt layer with 500 meter of rock, and then 25 kilometers away, there's rising the pillar. So they've overpressured it with a factor of 100,000 at least. And the third observation is that this pillar showed movement of salt of only, a centimeter, maybe, whatever. Not a lot, anyway. And if you calculate it, the movement will be less than a millionth of the distance of 25 kilometers they have to modelize. So this experimental data is a factor of 100,000 times a million away from the model. Yeah, do you copy? So that's not very helpful for the model. Now another one. This is their story. This is their story. And, well, to start with their conclusion, this has been published. Salt flows like a fluid. And what are we talking about? Solid salt. Solid salt flows like a fluid. That's the conclusion out of all this. And this is their model. This is in time. It started long ago, about 250 million years ago, and then up to the present. You have a layer of salt evaporated out of water somehow, 1 kilometer thick layer of salt, and then building up slowly a layer of, suddenly there is no salt delivered out of the water, but the water will now start delivering sediments. So it's set, and it's all underwater, and the water will continue to deliver more sediments and more sediments and more sediments. So this whole model, everything you look at is underwater now, continuously. And what they then do is, it's this layer of salt is in an extension area. So there is a mysterious power, a mysterious force here, and a mysterious force over there, and you extend, you pull off this layer of mud. You pick up your layer of mud, you just pick it up somehow, and you pull it away, and then 25 kilometers away, a crack arises. Whoa, it's mystery. Mystery. And this layer of sediments is grounded on the salt. So normally you would say, take the salt away and everything on top of salt will flow with it. No, the salt flows that way and the sediments comes to your way. Yeah, that's nice. I like that kind of models. Yeah. Now we have a problem. Everything is underwater. So when the crack arises, the crack will be filled with sediments again. So you have to continue. You have to open the crack continuously. So this mysterious power is continuously active. And then, of course, a reactive diapirism will start. The piercing of salt will start because you have a differential loading, and then it will start. And after a while, it becomes active diapirism because the overburden load pressurizes the salt and becomes more dense than the salt, and then the salt will, well, I've addressed that already because that's also a bit difficult. And then at a certain moment of time, it's that successful, the piercing of salt is that successful that ile arises above the water. So the salt has been lifted up above the water, which means that all the sediments will be delivered not on the ile, but in the sea around, surrounding it. So then you have a passive diapirism. It will just go, and no extension is required anymore. So, and then at least you will have, as last, you will have an allochthonous sheep advance. Well, I don't buy that at all. Okay. I think that these observations do show that geologists have a problem with their models. And we have another experiment. You can simply go to the shop and buy a lava lamp and do this experiment yourself. When you have a lava lamp, there is a piece of wax, a solid wax, laying on the bottom of a lava lamp, and there is water on top of it. If you then heat on the lamp, you switch on the lamp underneath it, the lamp will produce some heat, and the solid wax will start melting because of the heat. And the wax, when it melts, becomes less dense than the water. So when it melts, it will go up, and it will form your pillar of salt. So this is an experimental observation of how you can make a salt pillar. It's quite a look-alike. And it's free of forces. It's without any trouble. It's just two fluids that will flow. And we have loads of experimental observations again, and we look into the Earth, we just see what we would expect to happen when you have a very watery flood delivering loads of sediments and injected from underneath, out of cracks in the very deep, there has been delivered a huge amount of magma, salt magma. And yeah, anyone can see how it's been finding its way. It's look at the distance. This is 500 kilometers. It's huge altogether. It's amazing. So it overruns enormous basins, and then became the sediments were delivered on top of them, and then it found a way up in these sediments, and then it melted together above the sediments and started flowing again. And this is a huge catastrophe in which very fast a lot of water, a lot of sediments, and a lot of salt was available. And it was all very fast because this salt is only short time flowing, because it will solidify very fast. So this is a short time event. That's what we see. And here again you see how it came from very deep area, and it rose up through all these sediments, it melted together, and then even it overturned 240 kilometers. That's not possible by solid rock. You can't push solid rock 240 kilometers away. That's ridiculous. That's only possible when it flows as a magma. We have also another experimental observation. When you have two liquids that don't mix together, they don't like each other, so like oil and water. And one of them is lighter, the lighter liquid is on the bottom. And I don't know how they did it in the laboratory, but they, on top of them, of this liquid, there was a more dense liquid. Then suddenly this less dense liquid will find its way very fast, going up. Do you copy? So you see how fast it goes. There is a turbulence, and that fast it's going. And what, behold, what do we find in Norway, in front of the Nordkap, at the coastline, the Nordkap? We find a salt layer 5 kilometers high, and within all these sedimentary, is all these sediments, mud, all these mud in there, like a fluid, this salt magma went up and solidified like this. So again, experimental observation that salt has been a magma. So I think we have a much stronger case than evolutionists have when we talk about salt layers. So that brings me to my fourth conclusion. It was only possible during a flood because all these sediments, it was a short time event as well, because only in a short time you can have magma available because it will solidify very fast. Liquid mud was injected with salt magma, and even mainstream geologists confirmed that salt has flowed like a fluid. That's important to understand. This is what they write in their papers. Solid salt flowed like a fluid. So we have the same observation here, only that it wasn't solid. It was fluid. So, and then I think they misinterpreted data. Right. Well, I'm an engineer. I like to go deep in this stuff, so I did my own tests. A brother of mine had an oven, and I bought some crucibles, and we melted loads of salt. And also that confirms that our ionic liquids are, when they solidify, they are quite lookalikes. You see the same crystals, you see, well, at this one I captured from a salt mine, and this is what I made myself. It's not really a big deal, no big difference. So I also did it with calcium sulfate with a mixture, and now I'm into, well, I've come to a halt now. I'm in big troubles with all this because now let me start with the flood. In the flood, you see an injection of magma underneath water, and the water gives a pressure upon your magma. Whereas my tests here, this oven is not pressurized. I'm in atmospheric pressure. So when I heat this salt up to 800 degrees Celsius, which is what we did, or maybe 900 degrees Celsius, then this calcium sulfate will become unstable. It decomposes. And I was producing sulfur gases, which meant that calcium oxide will stay in my crucible, which is not a salt. So the solid of this is not anymore a salt, it's something different. So my crucibles broke because my crucibles failed. The oven was replenished with salt. The oven has been damaged as well. I'm quite in trouble, I must say, with this test. So I might need some help. Maybe someone can help me. But I want to show how all this layering that we find in the salt formation, how we can make that from an ionic liquid as well. However, I'm not able to do this test. I'm quite stuck. So maybe someone has some idea. I know from Leicester University, they know a lot about ionic liquids. I really would like to have someone from this university on board. Maybe here someone. If so, then please come to me. Well, funding always handy. So a summary, and I'm early, Philip, so I can extend my presentation a bit, if it's all right. But the summary is quite simple, I think so. The salt formations certainly are not evaporized, that's just storytelling. I think it's a magma that solidified within mud. I think I've made a very strong case to do so. This floodwater, I have to address that as well. This floodwater that came out of the Great Deep, And if you water pressurize at a very high deep, it's been pressurized by itself, by its own wave, then minerals will dissolute in water. So when you have a flood, what bursts out of the great deep, these minerals dissoluted in the water will come in an atmospheric condition and will crystallize and precipitate out and deliver sediments. So the sediments are not in the first place caused by erosion, what geologists always say. And when a geologist sees sediments, he says, oh, there must have been an erosion process. When I see sediments, I see, oh, there must have been a precipitation process. You see the difference? So I think it's very important. Salt testifies to the flood. And now my request to you, can you please help to resalt the church? So if you have ideas, if you want to go into your church or to student groups or schools, whatever, and you need my presentation, and please send me an email. I will send it to you. You can do it by yourself or I will help. It doesn't matter. It's also being presented in the Journal of Creation. It's on the bookstore, I think. It still be there. I just 2 months ago published in the most recent Journal of Creation, Salt, Magma and Sediments Interfingered. So as I still have some minutes, I can share something more. This is nice. This is nice. What we now see, this is all suboceanic. It's all underwater. And you can imagine if this salt pierces the mud, then a lot of steam will arise from this salt pillar because all the water will evaporate. And that helps to bring the salt up higher because of the law of communicating vessels. The water column plus the mud column will push up the salt column and the steam column. The steam column is only gas. So this salt column, the salt pillar will rise very high up. And on every salt pillar on the around the world, everywhere, and these are underneath America, we will see a certain amount of cap rock. A certain amount of cap rock. This is mostly calcium carbonate. This is in more detail. And so there's a lot of calcium carbonate. Calcium carbonate is what you find in your kettle at home. When you heat up water, calcium carbonate will fall out. It's chalk. It's just chalk. So this cap rock, there is no sodium chloride found in this cap rock. That means that the chalk that was delivered by evaporating the water, there was no sodium chloride in the water. That means it was a freshwater flood. Isn't that nice? And that's handy when you come out of the ark and water wasn't, and the earth was not replenished by salt water, but by fresh water. That means you can grow vegetables and wine, and you make your own wine, that kind of things. That's only possible if you had a freshwater flood. And that's what evidence shows us. So I'll leave it to that then. All right? Thank you very much.